Good morning. Please take your seats. I called the meeting of General Committee on Democracy, Human Rights, and Humanitarian Questions to order. Colleagues, the agenda for this meeting has been distributed. Could I please invite you to adopt the agenda? Are any objections? No. One objection.
No, une seule, je l'ai dit tout à l'heure à votre collaborateur. Hier, nous avons demandé de vérifier qu'en ce qui concerne les résolutions ou les amendements, que les parlementaires qui ont signé, nous puissions avoir la liste, non pas qui sont présents selon le règlement, mais qui sont bien à la Convention. Parce que nous avons vérifié, dans certains amendements, on a sait que certains parlementaires n'étaient pas à la Convention. Et vous n'avez pas tenu compte. Donc j'aimerais bien que toutes les résolutions qui passent, ou tous les amendements, le secrétariat puisse nous garantir, nous donner la liste des gens qui sont signataires et qui sont également présents. Parce que la règle s'applique à tout le monde. Voilà, merci Madame la Présidente, et j'espère que ce travail sera fait.
It's me who thanks to you for your question. It's a good opportunity to clarify all the situation now. And I can answer you reading 2 points of Rule 24. Second point, point number two. Signatures of members of the Assembly who sign an amendment are valid provided they register for and attend the annual session. Number three, in the event that a member of the Assembly who registered for but cannot attend the annual session due to an avoidable obligation, his or her signature shall remain valid, provided that the President of the Assembly is notified according by the head of the delegation. The Russian delegation don't notify the president. It's very different for comparing to the case of the Greek delegation that are not in the present in our meeting, are not participating, but they notify the president that they cannot be present for internal questions, as everybody knows. Okay? It's clear for you?
Oui, mais j'aimerais que vous vérifiez pour l'ensemble des délégations, parce qu'il y a des absents. Donc, à partir du moment où il y a un absent, il doit être montré qu'il y a une obligation impérieuse qui n'était pas là. Et c'est ce que nous voulons savoir, madame.
Yes,
merci,
but,
je connaissais les textes, merci de me les relire,
yes,
mais
they,
je les connaissais, mais je voulais maintenant être sûr que le secrétariat puisse nous fournir notre demande quand on demandera que tout le monde soit bien là. Merci.
Merci. The Russian delegation had all the information. They don't inform
mais madame,
the president.
Madame, je ne parle pas au nom de la dévolution russe, madame. Je ne parle pas de la délégation russe, je ne suis pas russe, je ne suis pas grec, je suis français, parlementaire français, qui souhaite que cela s'applique à l'ensemble des délégations. Ce
oui.
n'est pas du tout pour un problème des Russes, c'est un problème pour l'ensemble du fonctionnement.
Oui.
Des... Merci. Alors, ne mélangez pas les choses, madame. Ayez au moins la délicatesse de ne pas mélanger les choses. Merci.
Merci. Now, are any objections to our agenda? No, the agenda is adopted. We will now continue to consider the supplementary items. The first supplementary item we will consider is the draft resolution on abducted and illegally detained Ukrainian citizens in the Russia Federation, sponsored by Mr. Semerak of Ukraine. I call Mr. Semerak to introduce the draft resolution. Mr. Semerak, the floor is yours. Where is...
Oh. Good morning, Madame Santos and all delegates from the national parliaments, members of Parliamentary Assembly. It's a pleasure and honor to start our day today, and I hope that this day will be very fruitful. The delegation of Ukraine takes the floor to draw the attention of OSCE Parliamentary Assembly to the ongoing violation of the Russian Federation of its Minsk commitments, OSCE commitments, and international obligations as it continues to illegally detain for over 1 year member of Parliament of Ukraine, Nadia Savchenko, Ukrainian filmmaker Oleg Sentsov, Crimean activist Alexander Kolchenkov, and other Ukrainian citizens. All those persons are political prisoners in Russia, together with other Ukrainian citizens who had been illegally detained for openly expressing their protest against Russian aggression and illegal occupation of the Autonomous Republic of Crimea and the city of Sevastopol, Ukraine. We view as unacceptable that Russia continues to ignore the fact that the Member of Parliament of Ukraine and member of the parliamentary delegation, permanent parliamentary delegation of Verkhovna Rada, Ukrainian Parliament, to Parliamentary Assembly of Council of Europe, Nadia Savchenko is expanded from arrest and prosecution as person enjoyed diplomatic immunity. The same situation was with another permanent member of Ukrainian delegation, Hancherenko, who was kept in Moscow during the funeral ceremony of Boris Nemtsov, who is the author of the report of the being of Russian arms in Ukraine, and he was killed in Moscow a few days before the presentation of this report. Dear colleagues, the delegation of Ukraine remains deeply alarmed over the illegal detention by the Russian Federation of other Ukrainian citizens: Gennady Afanasyev, Oleksiy Cherniy, Mykola Karpyuk, Stanislav Klykh, Yuri Soloshenko, Valentin Vyhivsky, and Sergey Litvinov, who are persecuted as a political prisoners in Russia in violation of their human rights and fundamental freedoms, and its contravention of the norms of the international law. We draw attention that the Russian authorities continue to deny access of Ukrainian consular officers to Ukrainian citizens kept in custody of the territory of the Russian Federation. And there are reports about the use of physical violence and torture against them to obtain testimony. In contravention of international standards on nationality, Russia continues to use the pretext of illegitimate conferral of the Russian citizenship to the residents of the Autonomous Republic of Crimea and the city of Sevastopol, Ukraine. Distinguished members of OSCE Parliamentary Assembly, with the adoption of the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly resolution, the Assembly will make an important step in adding to the international efforts in facilitating the release of Nadia Savchenko, and that is my colleague and as well your colleague, and other Ukrainian citizens illegally detained in Russia. I think that OSCE Parliamentary Assembly will add its strong voice to those of the parliamentary institutions all over the world that Russia Federation should release all Ukrainian citizens. And to the end, I want to add that during these days that we are working here in Helsinki, Russian authorities change the for more strict law break to Nadia Savchenko, and I can say that probably that is one of the reaction of the Russian Federation and Russian authorities on sanctions that EU put it on Russian authorities and Russia as well. Thank you very much, and I hope that this resolution will be voted positively.
Thank you. The debate on the draft resolution is now open. I would like to remind speakers to keep their remarks as brief as possible, and in any event, no longer than 2 minutes. I don't have inscriptions till now. I don't know if someone wants to, from Kazakhstan. Okay.
Уважаемые коллеги, уважаемый председательство, я присоединяюсь к мнению многих коллег и вас, госпожа председатель, о том, к сожалению, что нет российской делегации, которая бы должна была бы выслушать, во-первых, такую резолюцию, сказать в ответ, что могла бы, и, во-вторых, они должны были почувствовать наши требования. Но ее нет, и это первое, как бы скажем, противоречие, которое бы не позволяет пройти такой резолюции. Второе. Я считаю, что когда резолюцию предъявляет одна из сторон конфликта, то она не может быть объективна. Потому что мы должны опираться на объективные сведения. А объективные сведения дают только наблюдатели ОБСЕ, которые говорят, что такие нарушения свойственны обеим сторонам конфликта. В связи с этим я считаю, что такую резолюцию здесь предъявлять невозможно. И третье, я считаю, что, во-вторых, когда вот такую резолюцию предъявляют в таком виде, то нас втягивают на стороне одного из конфликтующих сторон. А это, я считаю, недопустимо. Поэтому такую резолюцию я голосую против. Спасибо.
Mr. Gerasimov from Ukraine.
Dear colleagues, I will be very short, as the Mr. Chairperson asked. We need to remember that our colleague, the active member of the Parliament of Ukraine, the active member of the European institutions, is now illegally detained and illegally kept in prison in Moscow. And also, we need to remember, the Russian officials kept women in the prison. Thank you.
And can I proceed one word from Ukraine's side?
No. First, make an inscription, and after that, you can speak. Okay, you can speak.
Okay, I will proceed because it looks like some of our colleagues doesn't understand in English. I will try in Russia.
Я бы хотел спросить, о каких двух сторонах конфликта, простите, вы говорите? Если вы признаете Россию второй стороной конфликта, вы должны признать, что тогда она вмешалась в конфликт в Украине. Мы говорим о наших гражданах, которые были захвачены на нашей территории чужими войсками. Надя Савченко не была в России. Она была захвачена у нас. И все те люди, которые сейчас находятся в России, они были захвачены на нашей территории войсками чужого государства. Какая другая сторона конфликта вам нужна? Скажите мне, пожалуйста. Эти люди сейчас находятся там, в тюрьме. И я хочу подчеркнуть еще раз, что то, что случилось с российской делегацией, случилось именно потому, что случился конфликт. Не мы им запрещали сюда приезжать. У них есть много депутатов, которые могут сюда приезжать. Часть из них попала под санкции, да. Это их право присылать сюда тех людей, которых они считают или не считают нужным. И второй момент. Если мы все время говорим про диалог, мы готовы к диалогу, мы открыты к диалогу, мы переходим к переговорам, несмотря на то, что наша территория оккупирована, а российская делегация позволяет себе обидеться на то, что часть их людей, часть, подчеркну, всего лишь 6 человек, не были допущены, и они разворачиваются и уходят. При этом в тот момент, когда они уходят, каждый день наша территория обстреливается, у нас погибают люди. Это не рассказ, это не сказки. Каждый день на территории Украины, в их дома, на дома наших людей приходят трупы. Эти люди умирают от российского оружия. Покажите мне супермаркет, в котором сепаратисты на территории Украины покупают танки и ракеты. Откуда они их берут? Давайте не лицемерить. Или мы признаем, что она сторона конфликта, и тогда мы по-другому к этому относимся. Или мы не признаем их стороной конфликта, и тогда, извините, это наши граждане, которые захвачены там, и они имеют дипломатический статус. Спасибо.
No more inscriptions? No. Mr. Merakov, to reply to the debate.
Thank you. I fully support my colleagues Mustafa Nayem and Artur. And I'm really asking all of my colleagues in the Parliamentary Assembly to support our position. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on draft resolution. As there are no amendments, I propose that we now formally move to a vote on draft resolution. Those who vote in favor, please raise your cards. Votes against. Abstentions. The amendment is adopted.
Resolution.
The resolution is adopted, not the amendment, the resolution. Okay. The final supplementary item that we will consider is the draft resolution on women and girls made vulnerable by armed conflict, crisis, or minority status, sponsored by Mrs. Fry of Canada. I call Mrs. Fry to introduce this draft resolution.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Just as we spoke to the last resolution and everyone was appalled that a member of parliament would be picked up in her own territory and held prisoner without due process, I think we need to remember that across the OSCE, in so many areas, women and girls are very vulnerable. They are vulnerable either because there is a conflict and they are refugees, or they seek to be refugees, or they're homeless. They are vulnerable because of their minority status across the OSCE. In Canada, for instance, we have Aboriginal women that the world is crying out for an investigation into missing and murdered Aboriginal Indigenous women in our country, and nothing is being done about it. They disappear, and suddenly no one knows where they are, and then their bodies are found. So we see women are vulnerable because of Indigenous status. We see women are vulnerable to violence because of their race, because of their ethnicity, because of their language, because they're vulnerable because they're poor, low socioeconomic status. And so I think we need to think about how we protect women from vulnerability. Some women are even vulnerable to violence just because they are women. And in many places, women are still considered to be chattel and to be owned by their spouses. So domestic violence is also an issue. And I think it is time that we take a stand here about violence of all kinds. We know, for instance, that a lot of the women in Libya and in Syria who are refugees have no men to protect them. I think we've come to a point in this day and age where women should not need men to protect them. Women should be protected by the state. They should be protected by rule of law. They should be protected by conscience. And so I think it's really important for us to think about these women who, because they are not protected, are also vulnerable to trafficking. They're vulnerable to organized crime. Many of these young girls are forced into marriage because at least it gives them male protection in some of these areas. And some of them are forced into prostitution because at least it puts food on the table for their families. And these are children that many of these women are responsible for. So I am asking you to think about this. I don't believe that there is a single nation within the OSCE that condones any of this violence. Time after time, we come to these meetings and we talk about the violence, and everyone thinks it's appalling. Everyone tut-tuts about it. But I do think it is time for us to finally stop talking and to do something about it. And this is the essence of my resolution, to do something about it. And I think we need to look at how we use our humanitarian and our foreign aid to help these women who are the most vulnerable. I think we need to look at how we collect data and statistics and pass it across the OSCE line so that we can follow these women that are being vulnerable and that are being trafficked across borders and that are having violence. We need to put legislation in that condones domestic, that does not condone domestic violence, that makes it a criminal act. So I'm asking us to, we all speak, I know you all agree with me, but let us now move to the next step, which is to take action and do something. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Debate on the draft resolution is now open. I would like to remind speakers to keep their remark as brief as possible and, in any event, no longer than 2 minutes. Inscriptions to the debate on this draft resolution? No inscriptions. We can move now to consider the amendments. 4 amendments have been tabled to draft resolution. I shall now allow the proposers of amendments to speak for a maximum of 1 minute. I shall then allow the same time to an opponent of the amendment. I shall then ask the sponsor of the draft resolution for her opinion before putting the amendment to the vote. I call Mrs. Aknazarova from Kyrgyzstan to propose the amendment 1.
После 4-го пункта я хотела бы добавить новый пункт, где я выражаю свою обеспокоенность в плане того, что сейчас высокий уровень насилия в отношении женщин, детей и молодежи, и также недостаточный доступ женщин к правосудию. В связи с тем, что у нас очень высокий уровень оплаты юристов, дети и женщины не могут оплатить. Также обеспокоена тем, что недоверие к судебной системе и юристам является одним из препятствий на пути справедливого доступа к правосудию. Кроме того, что с барьерами при исполнении судебных решений, механизм исполнения судебных судов слабый и в значительной степени неэффективный. В связи с этим я хотела бы включить этот пункт.
Thank you. Does anyone wish to speak against? No one? Mrs. Fry, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I think this is an excellent amendment because I think many women indeed live in states within the OSCE where they have no access to justice. And because they're poor, because they're vulnerable, and because of their minority status, they actually have no ability to have the law on their side. So I would approve this amendment.
I shall now put Amendment 1 to the vote. Votes in favor, please raise your cards. Votes against? Votes against? No. Abstentions? One abstention. The amendment is adopted. Amendment 2, I call again Mrs. Aknazarova from Kyrgyzstan to propose this amendment.
Также я хотела ввести новый пункт. Где хотела бы отметить, а последние годы мировое сообщество столкнулось с беспрецедентными по масштабам и последствиями проблемами как внутренняя и внешняя миграция среди женщин, которые сегодня далеко не только от своего решения, но и от адекватного осмысления. Также здесь речь идет о том, о стремительном распространении различных форм социального насилия, среди которых особую угрозу представляет экстремизм, которыми своими деструктивными проявлениями, в частной религиозной сфере, представляют серьезную угрозу безопасности страны и нормальному решению развитию общества. Ведь устойчивое развитие напрямую зависит от обеспечения безопасности. Религиозный экстремизм ни в коем мере не может осуществляться с религией вообще. Это лишь ее радикальные извращенные формы, которые ради достижения поставленных их инициаторами целей трансформируют религию в идеологический инструмент, оправдывающий любые средства, включая и насильственные. С фундаментализмом и экстремизмом на религиозной основе должно бороться все – общество и государство, в том числе правительство. Имеется правительство направлять свои законодательные инструменты. Методы борьбы могут быть различными. Государство должно устранять социально-экономические и политические условия, способствующие возникновению экстремизма, и пресекать противозаконные действия, деятельность экстремистства. Экстремистов, а общество при помощи общественных и религиозных объединений, средств массовой информации и тому подобное, должно противодействовать религиозному экстремизму, противопоставляя экстремистским идеям гуманистические идеи и принципы толерантности гражданского общества и согласия. Для преодоления такого рода экстремизма могут применяться политические, социальные, психологические, информационные, силовые и другие формы. Спасибо за внимание.
Thank you. Does anyone wish to speak against? No. Mrs. Fry.
Thank you again, Madam Chair. I think this is an excellent amendment. I like it very much. I know that even in my own country of Canada, which is a member state of the OSCE, that girls are being moved out of rural parts of Canada into cities where they are subjected to societal violence and to criminal elements and to prostitution and to various elements of social violence. I also think that the influence of religious fundamentalism is an important piece to bring about. I think even, again, within Canada, we saw two young women and their mother who were killed because of the fact that the father, who was living in Canada and against Canadian law, actually murdered them because of honor killings, because these girls were intending to marry or go out or date young men. And so the rule of law must prevail in these instances, and the state has a duty, and so do we as parliamentarians, and so do NGOs have a duty to protect. So I approve this amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. I shall now put this amendment to the vote. I'm going to put amendment 2 to the vote. Votes in favor? Votes against? Votes against? Abstentions? The amendment is adopted. Amendment 3, I call Mrs. Aknazarova from Kyrgyzstan to propose the amendment.
Отмечая уровень насилия, хотела бы отметить о коррупции, ксенофобии, неравный доступ к качественному образованию, здравоохранению, правосудию и безопасности жизни. В связи с вышеизложенными я предлагаю поправку, содержащую призыв странам региона ОБСЕ направить свои усилия на создание обществ, свободных от насилия, коррупции, ксенофобии, на создание таких условий и возможностей, когда каждый член общества может получить доступ к качественному образованию, здравоохранению, правосудию и безопасной жизни. Спасибо.
Thank you. Does anyone wish to speak against this amendment? No. Mrs. Fry.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I support the amendment.
I shall now put this amendment to the vote. Votes in favor? Votes against? Against? Abstentions? The amendment 3 is adopted. Amendment 4, I call Mrs. Akhnazarova from Kyrgyzstan to propose the amendment.
Во второй поправке я отметила, а в этой поправке я хотела бы призвать, в связи с возложенными то, что во второй поправке, призвать государства участников ОСКЕ проводить постоянный криминологический мониторинг деятельности религиозных движений, организаций и формирований экстремистского толка, вовлекающих женщин в свои сети, и создать систему координации специализированных и неспециализированных субъектов профилактики в деле противодействия преступности террористической и экстремистской направленности. Спасибо.
Thank you. Does anyone wish to speak against? No. Mrs. Fry.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. There are parts of this that I support. But I am hesitant to support this amendment, mainly because it is contrary to civil liberties if we are to monitor every activity of religious movements to look for criminal activities. I think it is something that I cannot support. While the part of the amendment that deals with the issue to look specialized and non-specialized prevention in institutions to counter terrorist and extremist crimes, I cannot support the amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. I shall now put this amendment to the vote. Amendment number 4 to the vote. Votes in favor? Count, please. Votes against? I think it's clear. Abstentions? The amendment 4 is defeated. That concludes the discussion of amendments. Thank you all. I propose that we now formally move to a vote on draft resolution as amended. Will those in favor of the adoption of draft resolution please raise their cards? Against, abstentions, the draft resolution is adopted. We come now to the election of committee officers for 2016 annual session of the Assembly. Nominations are closed at 9 a.m. Mr. Alizard has decided to withdraw his candidacy. I will give him the floor for a minute to explain. Monsieur Alizard.
Oui, Madame le Président, simplement pour confirmer ce que vous venez d'annoncer, il semblerait qu'il y ait eu un accord entre les différents groupes, et je crois que si nous recherchons un consensus pour travailler tous ensemble, je me devais de retirer ma candidature. Donc je confirme qu'effectivement, je ne suis pas candidat à ce poste de vice-président. Merci.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur Alizard. The International Secretariat informs that the following nominations have been received in the table office. Isabel Santos, me. For chair from Portugal. For vice chair, Mr. Geir-Jørgen Bekkevold from Norway. Mrs. Ivana Dobezova from Czech Republic. Mr. Ignacio Sanchez Amor from Spain. For rapporteur, Mrs. Gordana Chomic from Serbia. For the conduct of the elections, I will now hand over to the International Secretariat. I have appointed Mrs. Fry from Canada, Mrs. Kiener Nellen from Switzerland, and Mr. Holm from Sweden. As the position of chair is not contested, I declare Oh, it's not me, it's the director of election.
Thank you. As the chair announced, she has appointed the three tellers. We would ask if they could please come up to the podium first to help oversee the conduct. As the position of chair is not contested, the nominee for that position, Ms. Isabel Santos from Portugal, is elected by acclamation in accordance with Rule 36.5. Likewise, as the position for rapporteur is not contested, the nominee for that position, Ms. Gordana Chomic from Serbia, is elected by acclamation. As the position of vice chair is contested, we will have an election by secret ballot. I remind you that the candidates are Mr. Geir Jürgen Bekkevold from Norway, Ms. Ivana Dobeshova from the Czech Republic, Mr. Ignacio Sanchez Amor from Spain. Ballot papers have been prepared for the election.
You are the tellers?
Yes. Yeah, if you go speak to Tom, he'll set. Ballot papers have been prepared for the election. To vote, please place a cross by the name of your preferred candidate. According to Rule 36.5, a majority of votes cast is required for a candidate to be elected. Therefore, if no candidate has obtained a majority, a second ballot will be required. Therefore, please come up and your voting card will be marked in case a second ballot is necessary. So please make sure to have your ballot marked when you come up to collect your ballot. We will just let them get settled, and then please come to the podium and collect your ballot. You must have your voting card with you. That's the yellow voting card for this committee. The committee will be suspended while the votes are counted and will then resume for the result to be announced. After that, the result of the elections will also be announced in the plenary session. If anybody has not voted yet, please make sure to do it in the next minute. We will give one more minute. So if anybody still... You have 1 minute. I'm going to even start the clock. Okay, the time for collecting ballots is now closed. Has anybody collected a ballot but not posted it in the ballot box yet? Okay, we'll start the counting of ballots.
So we have now 1 second round between two candidates, between Mrs. Dobezova and Mr. Oh, I must announce the numbers. Mr. Begvold, 17 votes. Mrs. Dobezova, 20 votes. Mr. Sanchez Amor, 27 votes. Now, we will have a second round between Mrs. Dobezova and Mr. Sanchez Amor. The ballot, I think, is not ready. Okay. Take your ballots and
the X.
And
lots of people did not put X.
Oh, okay. And Dex.
The tellers would like to remind everybody to please make a clear X as your choice, a cross.
I must. I must appeal to all people to put an X in the ballot, in the candidate. It's a cross, please, not a smiling or a visa or something more funny, okay? A cross, okay?
The tellers will close the voting in 1 minute. If anybody has not yet voted, please make sure to do so now. If you have any friends out who are out for a smoke, please call them immediately. The voting will close in 1 minute. Thank you. The voting is closed.
One more.
Oh. I don't know. It's up to the tellers to decide, huh? Okay.
Can I also vote? Is it possible?
It's
for you to decide.
Okay, so we have a. Let's hope we don't have to do just once where I saw it completely equal, and then we do it by lot. We pull a name out of a hat.
Oh, yeah. That was
I call the committee to order to announce the results. And the results are votes cast 59, Mrs. Dobezova 29 votes, Mr. Sanchez Amor 28 votes. Blank ballots 1, spoiled ballots 1. Therefore, Mrs. Dobezova is elected.
I would like to thank all of you. Thank you very much. Thank you once more. And I would like to congratulate to candidates who were candidating with me. I am very glad that we had good competition. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to thank to all of you for your cooperation during this meeting. And I also want to say thanks to all of you for your trust in me all along of these years. But I would like to announce that this will be my last year in this function. And next year, we need to elect another chair. Democracy needs rejuvenation and needs examples, and I'm giving the example. I'm exit in next year from this position. Now, thank you all for your cooperation and for your trust. This concludes the work of Third Committee for the 24th annual session. I would like to thank colleagues for their most constructive cooperation in the work of the committee. The meeting is now closed. Thank you.